office or otherwise sanctioned. As a matter of fact, in the last 1 month, two CECs and one CEO and the county secretary have been given a vote of no confidence by the county assembly. Critical state officers, including CECs and members of the County Public Service Board, have not been approved by the Assembly, making it difficult to employ staff even for critical health services. Services to the people of Kirinyaga are affected and will continue to be affected, even when this process is over. Whatever its results, the negative impact of the process will linger. It is also an expensive process for all concerned, with lawyers and other professionals, tons of documents, witnesses, and other attendant costs. It is therefore not surprising that the Constitution and the County Government Act reserves the impeachment solely to circumstances in which gross and serious violation of the Constitution and the law and serious abuses of office are proved to have been committed by the governor. The courts have severally and consistently given decisions affirming the need for those seeking impeachment to obtain a high threshold for misconduct and violations of law before they can successfully remove an elected officer from their position. Impeachment and removal from office was never intended and should never be based on falsities, innuendos, rumors, hearsay, conjecture, and certainly not malice. Honorable senators, secondly, an impeachment process is required by the law to be procedurally without reproach. It must respect the rules of natural justice, including the right to a fair hearing, and involve the people through public participation processes. That, as my lawyers will show, never occurred in this process. No formal public participation took place. The decision to proceed with impeachment, despite a subsisting court order, was made on Monday. I was purportedly sent an invitation to attend the proceeding on the same Monday to appear the next day. Truth be told, the notice to appear was brought to my office at 10 a.m. on Tuesday, when the motion was being debated. I was not even in the county on the day. By 3 p.m. on the same day, the impeachment proceedings had been completed. It is to avoid this sort of possible malpractice by county assemblies and to protect the integrity of the removal process that the drafters of the Constitution and the County Government Act wisely placed the Senate at the center of the impeachment process of governors. In this process, the Senate is the preeminent organ that ensures that the impeachment process is fact-based, has the requisite threshold, and is procedurally fair. The Senate is also to ensure that an impeachment process is not used to achieve collateral political purposes or push personal agendas. And it is not calculated to scandalize, embarrass, malign, or defame an individual. Unfortunately, what is before you is in every respect false, unfounded, and salacious allegations which have no place in an impeachment motion. Honorable senators, my lawyers will be taking you through the allegations that formed the basis of my impeachment. Without rehearsing that presentation, I must say that the grounds that formed the basis of my impeachment and which this committee is now tasked to superintend are an affront to the very serious process that the Constitution and the law have prescribed for the removal of a governor from office. The grounds contain allegations that are obvious falsities, unfounded and malicious. They relate to minor administrative issues that would easily have been clarified by a routine inquiry. How can anyone justify summoning an entire county assembly and now the Senate, where the allegation asserting gross violation of the Constitution is failing to deliver a state of the county speech at the county assembly, a requirement that does not even exist in the Constitution, not to mention that I actually did deliver two states of addresses in both the years that I have been in office, with one scheduled towards September this year. That will be proven. How does the Senate of the Republic of Kenya be called to sit in inquiries into allowances to board members whose approval was made way back in 2014 by the SRC for all boards in the country? How can this Honorable House be called upon to sit in review of tenders which were never appealed by the participating bidders, where there was no allegation of malpractice or non-performance or overpricing, and no single allegation that the governor was conferred any personal benefit or that loss was occasioned in the county? I would like to mention on one specific tender, the 50 million tender. This team will be shocked to know there was no 50 million tender given to Velocity, and that will be proven. There was also no 30 million shilling payment to Velocity, another lie done again for intended purposes of ruining somebody's reputation. That again will be proven by my lawyers. You will be shocked to find the allegations even include the purchase of the governor's vehicle, whose budget was duly approved by the same assembly. The purchase was not from a dealer, but from the manufacturers of the vehicle, Toyota Kenya, that supplies government vehicles under a framework contract negotiated by the Ministry of Public Works. Why would the business of Kirinyaga County be stopped at the Senate, as the Senate is called upon to interrogate travel interests, to show the extent of these falsities and the malice? The Assembly knowingly added three non-existent entries to the interest list amounting to 4.6 million. These monies were never paid to the governor. They have no evidence to show that that money was paid. They were false entries to make and malign the name of the governor. Why else would an assembly do that? In their enthusiasm to prosecute the governor, they even allege I did not travel on trips where the leader of majority, the chief accuser in this process, was present and is photographed with me in the US and in Italy during those two trips. There can be no higher abuse of the process of impeachment, and indeed no higher abuse of the power of the Assembly than the process before you today. Honorable Senators, the Senate exists to protect devolution. While this must include strengthening the oversight capacity of county assemblies, focus must shift to protecting governors and county executives from the excessive overstepping of the oversight power of the county assemblies. Most governors avoid impeachment and firing of their cabinets only by bending over backwards to cater to the personal demands and whims of MCAs. Budgets are only passed if allocations are aligned to the personal desires of certain individuals. MCAs go as far as to demand to approve payments to contractors before they are made, contrary to the County Government Act. Failure to keep the MCA's wheel sufficiently oiled can earn you an impeachment. Unfortunately, all these prejudices, service delivery, and development in counties